Hello and welcome to Locks and Keys. My name is Matthew Corbett and we're going to make a very special journey. We're currently on the River Humber and over here is Kingston upon Hull. But we're going to head west through Yorkshire, up the Pennines, over the Brow into Lancashire and end up at our destination, which is Liverpool and the Mersey Docks. So sit back, enjoy yourself and relax as we begin this 197¼-mile journey. Yes, Locks and Keys is going coast to coast. Over the next 10 weeks, we're going to prove that England really is split in two by water. And in doing so, we're going to be privileged to see some of the most spectacular scenery.
And the joy of this journey is that every day will offer us a different view from a variety of different vessels. I'll be getting to grips with several sized boats as we make our way from the Humber and via the River Ouse onto one of England's busiest waterways, the Aire and Calder Navigation. Then onto this country's longest canal in both length and construction time, the Leeds-Liverpool Canal. En route, just like me, you'll have the pleasure of sampling stunning staircase locks and visiting architectural gems, as well as witnessing firsthand the ever-changing face of canal-side life in 21st century Britain. Massive expanses of water await us, some continually stir with the weight of age-old industries, whilst others are a haven for peace and tranquility. But what links them all is that they are there for us all to see and to sample. Starting with today's trip from one crucial port at Hull to another 50 miles inland. And once Goole has offered us an insight into its rich heritage, the heavily industrial landscape surrounding Ferrybridge greets us as we arrive in West Yorkshire.
Travelling in a westward direction along the River Humber. And just behind us is the jewel in its crown, the Humber Bridge.
Work was completed in 1981, 8 years after it began, and over a century after the idea of building a crossing from Yorkshire to Lincolnshire was first raised. The project to build what was then the world's longest suspension bridge was blighted with problems as fierce North Sea winds caused chaos for workers, and the river's notoriously unstable sandbanks and beds contributed to further construction delays. But once the road sections were floated upstream on barges and hoisted into place, two counties were joined as one, high above this often unrelenting stretch of deep water.
You know, I know Hull pretty well because for 25 years, 1 week each year, I used to come to play the theatre here. But it's only actually by being here on the Humber, as opposed to driving over it, that you get the full impression of this 37 miles of murky water. I've been boating for 30 years, so boating's obviously a very important part of my life, almost as important as my furry little ex-partner. But the great thing about the journey that we're making is that I get to steer a lot of the boats. Having said that, I'm not going to steer this one. I'm going to leave this to the experts. At the helm, we've got Matt, and I'm going to talk to the skipper, a man who knows these waters like the back of his hand, Paul Cooper. Paul. How are you?
All right, how are you?
Sobriety. Tell me about the boat. What sort of boat is she?
She was built originally as a Humber keel, a type of sailing barge, and she's nearly now 100 years old, 1909. She converted into a motor barge somewhere just between the wars and has been operating with the sobriety project as a community boat for the past 30 years.
Now, I know obviously you're not 100 years old, but just if you could step back that amount of years, what would we find in the hold of this boat 100 years ago? What do you think?
If she was still a trading barge and 100 years ago under sail, she could have been carrying any sort of raw materials from the Hull docks or Grimsby docks areas up towards the canal system at Goole for further transport inland. She could be carrying farm produce from any of the farmland around here where there would have been staithes on the riverside, where she could have been carrying fresh produce into Goole or if we're going the other way back down to Hull. They were general cargo boats.
And would she ever stray out into the ocean itself?
Generally speaking, not these boats. There were primarily three types of local trading barge on Humber. There were keels, which had a single large square sail. There were sloops, which were more estuarial boats than the keels were. These are upper river boats primarily. And then there was a type of vessel called a billy boy, which was basically a seagoing coastal barge.
So this boat, whilst it's very charming, very unusual shape, I mean, it's very blunt at the front. There must be days when there are waves on this estuary, and is that tough going?
Yeah, the Humber creates very, what are called short, steep seas. The wave heights aren't particularly high in terms of sea-going waves. What they are is short and very frequent, and they do tend to be able to throw a boat off its course quite easily.
Obviously, you're an expert on the Humber estuary. What's your experience of this waterway?
People do, to a certain extent, feel that the Humber is a dangerous piece of water. And potentially it is, but then all pieces of water are. It is just a piece of water. If you know what you're doing, it ain't as bad as people think.
It doesn't seem very busy. I mean, is today a typical day?
It is relatively quiet at the moment, but also we're running up the upper part of the river relatively early on the tide. Shipping that's further up the river system in places like Goole and Haldendyke and up on the Trent are just at this moment preparing to leave. They've only just started to get enough water to get out of their berths. Ships going up to those areas are behind us.
Paul, I don't see a lot of pleasure craft here. If somebody who owns a narrowboat has got the thought that perhaps they'd like to do this journey in their narrowboat, can they do that?
Yes. They'd be foolish to without a reasonable degree of river experience of some sort, without a certain degree of local knowledge, and you'd certainly need to pick your weather. Up to now, the day's been fantastic. You could have had a narrowboat out on the Humber today. One of the problems with narrowboats is a lot of them have a well deck on their foredeck. That fills with water. If a wave comes over, that gets in the body of the boat, and most narrowboats would have difficulty getting rid of that.
So you're saying it's possible, but probably not to be recommended?
It's a well-planned passage. It's not something you would generally do on a spur of a moment. Yeah. You would think about how do you block access of water into your boat, what was the weather of that particular day, what knowledge you had.
Paul, I'm not going to ask you to stand around for any longer because I've just noticed, I don't know if you have, but there's a very large ship over your shoulder.
Over
so can I recommend that you go and deal with that?
Thank you
Thanks very much
right,
for
I'll
all
see
the
you
information.
Later. Take care.
Off you go. And over these 10 programmes, there are plenty of waterways to explore, not forgetting the numerous boats that will lead me through Yorkshire on the River Ouse, then the Aire and Calder navigation, until it meets the Leeds-Liverpool Canal. I'll then swap the White Rose for the Red and the textile towns of Lancashire before culminating our monumental voyage on the Mersey. But at present, I'm heading west on the Humber towards Goole and growing accustomed to wide expanses of water, all bordered by green and empty fields. But then starker shapes start to appear in the form of towering cranes, a sure sign that a port is on my horizon. And the man responsible for reclaiming this former marshland and igniting Goole's trade links to the world was Cornelius Vermuyden, a pioneering Dutchman who constructed the Dutch River, which nowadays runs parallel with the start of the Aire and Calder Navigation Canal as it journeys west.
Here I found a logistical labyrinth of waterways and plenty of visual reminders of why Goole has long enjoyed such a pivotal role amongst traders wishing to transfer goods from coast to coast. Even now, container boats can see their cargoes unloaded and whisked away along a motorway within just half an hour of docking here. And Goole's success as a port is entirely responsible for the town that would eventually grow beside it, with the town's skyline illustrating how industry and habitation can coexist. Nowadays, fertilizers, cement, and Scandinavian timber are common cargoes, a far cry from the day when up to 2,000 tons of coal could be transported through here from South Yorkshire on any single shipment. And reminders of these halcyon days would soon become even more tangible at the Yorkshire Waterways Museum, as I prepare to jump on board a remnant from this county's illustrious coal mining past. Here, even landlubbers can stroll around and sample the working life of the boatmen and women of yesteryear. The exhibits on show inside fully illustrate how the landscape has evolved to match the increase in passing trade. There are plenty of reminders too that coal once proved richer than gold to the people of Goole. And as a boatman myself, the most exciting thing by far is a chance to relive a bygone age and board a boat that was integral in carrying so much of this town's cargo. Ernie, tell me something about the boat. What's she called?
This boat's called the Welldale, which is named after a pit.
Okay.
Welldale pit.
It feels incredibly powerful. I mean, there's presumably quite some motor in the back there.
Yes, the engine she develops, 135 horsepower. Yeah. Which, by today's standards, isn't a huge amount of horsepower, but it's a large engine and it drives a large prop. Slowly, of course, but... Yeah.
And this boat was built just for the one reason, that was to pull things called Tom Puddings, isn't that right?
That's quite correct. We did use them for towing ships around the docks sometimes, but, yeah, that's basically all it was.
So, Ernie, in front of us is a very strange thing, and that's called a J-bus. And this was used to pull Tom Puddings. Now, what on earth is a Tom Pudding?
Well, basically, it's a steel box, or a compartment, as they were called.
How much coal was in each compartment?
40 tonnes was the most they would probably put in them, because it wasn't
40 tonnes?
About 40 tonnes, yeah.
And how many compartments?
The trains to Castleford in the West Country was 19, and the trains we used to take to Doncaster, there were 17.
The Tom Puddings would snake along this stretch of Yorkshire's waterways, then, upon arrival in Goole, they'd line up at each of the five hoists that once stood here, ready to be temporarily unhooked from the J-bus and hydraulically lifted and emptied through massive coal chutes. And one of the many volunteers who still maintain this last remaining hoist was on hand to demonstrate this ingenious landmark. This is really impressive. Just imagining the coal, you know, a big mound up the top. Run me through what happens next. How does the coal get into the ship?
It's brought across to the ice. There was one pan at the time was pushed under the ice, under this cradle.
Yeah, yeah.
Just the one. Then that was lifted up. From there, two men step aboard, what we call tippers, put the dogs on. Then
hang on, put the dogs on, what are dogs?
They're like clamps to stop it tipping over.
Oh, right.
Anyway, it went to the top. When they got to the top, then chute was loaded into the ship's hold.
Yeah.
The pans was lifted up, tipped over, and it all just emptied into the ship's
hold. So how many operators would it take? Three? Two guys down here?
A driver and...
A driver upstairs?
Two tippers.
So would they, like, ring a bell when it was ready?
Oh, yeah, there's a ring bell. There's a bell there somewhere, a rope.
And was it dangerous?
Did people get injured?
There was galloping about on these all that way up.
Yeah.
These deck ends, that's all they had to run on.
Yeah. Did you ever work on these?
Oh, I mean, telling him about on canals, yeah.
So you've actually done this?
Oh, yeah, we did this, yeah.
You've done this job, I tell you what, rather you than me.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm really thrilled about seeing those. It's like, it's a living museum, this, isn't it? I mean, you're actually seeing something
that's really working. That's right.
That's great.
My journey from the Humber to the Mersey presents the perfect opportunity to jump aboard several different vessels. Each promises their own individual identity, and as I've seen over the past 30 years, the variety of styles and shades on display is very much a personal taste. Ah, at last, a chance to try out a boat on a canal as I head on towards Ferrybridge on the outskirts of Castleford.
Welcome to my third vessel in the space of a few short hours. This is the Kirkstall Flyer, and it's a sort of wide-beam boat that was frequently used here on the Air and Calder navigation for commercial purposes.
Flyboats were in effect, the courier service of their day. The speed enabled them to work around the clock, transporting perishable goods across the canal network. Today, though, we're taking things a little more sedately. Old and new, standing side by side in Ferrybridge, and all still forming transportation links across the country. And surprising as it may seem, the bridge before me holds a very strong bond with the opposite end of our journey. Along with his son, Jesse, Bernard Hartley built the bridge from which the town takes its name early in the 19th century, 4 decades prior to Jesse revolutionising the Liverpool that we still see today with his design for the Albert Dock. There are plenty of soaring chimneys lining our journey through West Yorkshire too, and straight ahead of me are the bellowing towers of Ferrybridge Power Station. These things are huge. Just a mile on from the industrialisation at Ferrybridge and with Castleford just around the corner, tranquility returns.
There's a curious sensation that somehow we are intrepid explorers going up an unknown river. It's rather like the African Queen or something. But it's definitely a river feeling. And I tell you what, anybody that would like a good adventure on a narrowboat, this is the place to come.
Today, West Yorkshire welcomes us with some splendid scenery surrounding Castleford. Then we're off towards Leeds, stopping off at Thwaite Mill's watermill before seeing how the city centre's architecture plans to utilise the waterways. As I make my way from Castleford to Leeds, it gives me the opportunity to take in some of the wonderful sights along the Air and Calder Navigation Canal. An industrious and integral waterway that for 3 centuries has crucially linked the supply of the ports and the demands of the rest of the country. It was originally built to link Leeds and Wakefield to the River Ouse, and soon proved a blueprint for other navigations across the country. By the 1760s, Even bigger boats wanted to use the system, a development that spurted the growth of towns such as Goole and a massive influx of commercial traffic. A subject that local historian John Goodchild is keen to share.
So when did commercialisation come to this area?
The industrialisation occurred in a variety of forms. The coal industry was the most particular one. But there were all sorts of other industries. Raw materials were the foundation of the prosperity of Castleford. Sand and coal to manufacture glass. At the end of the 18th century, in the mid-1780s, a fineware pottery was established at Castleford. It's on the site of potteries which had existed somewhat earlier, making use of local clays. So there is local clay, there is local coal, there is local sand, there is local lime. The raw materials for these two major industries, where Castleford became quite important indeed. What was suggested to be the largest glass bottle manufacturer in the world, Breffitt's, immediately below Castleford, flourished, as did many of the Castleford glassworks until the depression between the two 20th century world wars.
But one of the most important ingredients, the waterways.
And the waterways to carry the goods away. For glass and for pottery, the waterways were very good indeed because they provided a much safer means of transporting the glass and the pots, which of course were liable to be broken in railway trucks, particularly the old unsprung railway wagons. So the waterway was very good for those.
So if we could step back 150 years, we might well find either side of this river industry.
Here we would have found large collieries on each side of the river, producing huge quantities of coal, and with their colliery staves, that is, the coal wagons coming up to load boats on the edge of the river.
Yes, we've seen one or two of these chutes that come down, and that presumably was the tip into barges.
Into boats, yes.
This prosperity of the air and coal as navigation was attributed to the chairman Thomas Bartholomew's radical decision to lengthen and deepen the locks along the canal. His foresight enabled massive vessels, including the coal-carrying compartment boats, or Tom Puddings as they call them around here, to navigate each lock system with far greater size loads, as well as carrying their cargoes far further inland.
The railways spelt the death knell for many canals,
absolutely,
did they not?
Yes.
But that didn't affect the air and calder the same way.
No. The importance of the air and calder, for example, is that it served the two important industrial towns of Leeds and Wakefield, whose traffic was to increase in the period of railway competition. So there was plenty of traffic for both railway and canal, and the air and calder, by means effectively of this railway train on the water, was able to most successfully compete with the railways.
So the ingenuity shown with this navigation's design soon left other canal systems looking pedestrian in comparison. And Lemonroyd Lock near Woodlesford is a superb example of the deep lock chambers that are scattered along this canal, all of which enabled the air and calder to handle so many big boats in its heyday and survive its newfound rivalry with the railways. This is actually an amalgamation of two separate and smaller locks, and the water level in here rises or falls by 13.5 feet as you pass through it. Now that's what I call a lock.
Mm-hmm.
Now, earlier on, I passed through Castleford Floodlock in the direction of Leeds. But what would I have seen if I turned left instead towards Wakefield? Well, a local museum curator can help fill in the gaps along this interesting 8-mile-long stretch of the Aaron Calder.
This is the Wakefield branch of the Aaron Calder Canal, and we're at Stanley Ferry, which is one of the jewels in the waterway crown, not just in Yorkshire, but in the whole country. Over there you have Stanley Ferry Aqueduct, which was built in 1839, and which is the model for the Sydney Harbour Bridge, only the Sydney Harbour Bridge was built 100 years later and is much bigger. This took 700 men to build, used 7,000 tonnes of stone from Bramley in Leeds and 1,000 tonnes of iron. When it opened in 1839, it totally changed the route into Wakefield, made it much faster and easier to use. We're now nearly in the centre of Wakefield. We're at Chantry Bridge, which was built in the 1340s and was the only crossing across the Calder. On the bridge, you can see a chapel, which is called Chantry Chapel. And it was some sort of spiritual insurance, because in medieval times, travel was both slow and dangerous, and people were worried that they wouldn't complete their journey successfully. So they prayed at the chapel for a safe journey before they set off. We're now at Falling Lock. Over there, we have the entrance to the original canal in 1702. That takes you right up to Chantry Chapel and the bridge there. But it was a bit of a mistake because you couldn't get from there to the other side of the bridge to go up into the Pennines. So in the 1760s, they opened Falling Cut, which we have here, with a lock to take us up round the weir and over to the Calder going off towards Huddersfield. We're now at Wakefield Floodlock. Come up the canal from Stanley Ferry along here, and boats would now go up towards the Pennines along the river and the canal in that direction. And here we've got the 1790s navigation warehouse. Now, this is a really important area because when the mill towns developed in the Industrial Revolution, there were no railways and everything had to be brought in and out by canal, and everything came through Wakefield. Now, that's okay, but the canals in the Pennines are smaller than the canals that we've just come along. And so everything had to be transshipped here, put into these warehouses, put into a new boat and sent up to Huddersfield and Lancashire. And so you can say that Wakefield was kind of the pantry of the Industrial Revolution, because everything was stored here that the people up there knew. And if things went wrong here, then people up there had no food, couldn't sell their materials, nothing could happen. So this is a really important area 200 years ago.
The further I travel, the more our scenery gives way to the industrial landscape of today's final destination, Leeds city centre. Although I still have plenty of time to look around a magnificent building that promises plenty of industry and interest. My journey to the outskirts of Leeds has brought me to Thwaite Mills, a series of splendid looking buildings with plenty to see inside. How far are we from the city centre here?
It's about a mile and a half as the crow flies. Or if you follow the canal.
It's amazing, because this is like an oasis of calm, isn't it?
It is. When you look around us, you wouldn't believe it. I'm in a heavily industrialised area.
It's a fantastic building, obviously extremely old. What did it produce?
This particular mill produced putty, It was actually a crushing mill.
Is it possibly what you put around windows?
That's right, yeah.
Really?
It actually finished production in 1976, so it wasn't that long ago either. It was using the power from the water to turn the wheels inside the mill, and this is how they produced the putty.
And what's it made from? What is putty?
Putty.
What is it?
It's just two mixtures. It's chalk, which is crushed, and linseed oil.
And is that why it was built, to make putty?
No, this is the second mill on the site. The first one was dated back to 1641. It's all to do with textiles. It was a fulling mill. It's part of the finishing process of cloth, where it's brought to the mill, put into rather large holes in the ground, and pounded with hammers in a mixture of fuller's earth and sheep's urine. Now, the sheep's urine actually strips all the oils out of the cloth so you can dye it afterwards. And the fuller's earth bonds all the fibres together so you can't pull it apart. So it was just one of the processes that was down here.
So we've had two usages so far. We've had the fabric.
That's right.
And the putty. Anything else?
Yeah, I mean, when the Joy family came in the 1820s, they crushed rapeseed for specialised oils. And we do have records stating that we actually sent a specialised oil for Stevenson's rocket up in the northeast, yeah. It also crushed flint and china stone for the pottery industry.
Was there pottery in Leeds then?
There was over 200 potteries in Leeds in its heyday.
Really?
The two main ones were the Leeds Creamware, which is world famous, and Bermantoff's, which is now an area in Leeds.
Has the building changed a lot? I mean, I noticed that there's quite a few blocked up windows, and has it changed?
Cosmetically on the outside, a little bit, yes, but on the interior, nothing at all. Nothing at all. We've had some health and safety features, such as walkways and fencing, but otherwise, it's as original as you can get.
It's living history.
It is, yes.
Of course, it was all thanks to this water. The water gave birth to the thing in the first place,
didn't it? That's right, yeah. Without the water, you wouldn't have a mill.
Interesting in locks to look at the vegetation on the side. I mean, here is nature clinging on by the skin of its teeth, but it manages. And here are plants actually growing out of the cracks in the wall. Amazing. Fascinating view. It's the countryside giving way to the city, gracefully. Welcome to Leeds. This boat, Valor, has come from a very interesting place. I wonder if we're following it or it's following us. This place has changed so much since I used to come here as a kid. All those years ago, it's really, really run down. And look at it, new buildings everywhere, apartments, offices. It reminds me very much of Castlefield in Manchester, which was similarly run down, and now it's a really vibrant place to live. And Leeds is heading the same direction.
We have a central stretch of the river and the canal system here, which had to work very hard for its living in the Industrial Revolution. And what we're trying to do now with the waterfront strategy that we have is to bring residential and recreational and many varieties of uses to enliven the river and to bring a balance of new development with the historic structures and buildings and places that are along this central stretch. The city's history goes back 800 years, but they've always been working rivers or canals as they came later. And now we're at the point where residential development, leisure development, and recreation are important to the life of the burgeoning commercial city. So the waterfront is a really crucial part of the evolution of the city from its industrial era into the new 21st century world. Along the river side and the canal side, there have been surviving warehouses, and there's been a mixture of new construction and old construction in bringing those back to life. So we've been trying not to do perhaps pastiche of the old, but add new pieces which will blend with the old and enliven the old. And now there are buildings emerging with a language of their own, but actually relying on references to materials and forms from the earlier buildings. The characteristic of the city is it's remained very compact and it hasn't lost its heart. It's been gradually renewed rather than renewed in single big endeavours, and so it's that continuity and change that we are part of even now in this period of considerable developments.
This is a monumentous occasion because I happen to know that from this point here, lock number one, it's only 127 and a quarter miles until we moor up in the Mersey docks. Yes, folks, we're up and running on the Leeds Liverpool Canal. A traditional canal deserves a traditional narrowboat. Although, of course, purists will notice it's a semi-traditional narrowboat. Anyway, with a new crew beside me, I've jumped aboard the Ward Aldham, ready to pass both the Kirstall flyboat and Leeds city centre. Legendary figures are ready to greet us today, starting with a religious repose at Kirstall Abbey. A chance to reminisce in my hometown, Guiseley, before we step back to the time of Sir Titus Salt. This is quite unusual for me because I'm used to narrow locks and this is a broad lock. And it's very important in broad locks to use ropes, which we don't normally use on narrow, so I've got to pay attention. The best option here is to tie her up to the side and take in the slack as the water level rises around you. This makes a change for me, having somebody else doing all the work. I could get used to this. Perfect. Sill is actually the sill, it's a stone piece underneath the water, and when you're coming down, you've got to be very careful, your back end stuck on the sill, otherwise the boat tips up and can sink, and has done. Not personally, I haven't done it, but almost. You caught anything?
Five.
See, I've never actually done the Leeds-Liverpool Canal, so all this is as new to me as it is to you. But what's really unusual, and I've never seen this before, is that the water is really clear. You can see all the reeds. Usually canals are, like, muddy and... But look at that. Makes you feel
feel quite small when you think about the hundreds of tons of water just being held back with two bits of wood. This notice can only be read as a reflection. The remains of a wooden icebreaker lie submerged. All right, lads. That's what it's all about, you see. Camaraderie. Everybody says hello. Everybody smiles. It's great. The river Aire is accompanying us as well along this leg of the journey. It may have eventually been substituted as a trade route by the far more direct canal, but in its time, this meandering river helped to supply stone for our next destination, Kirkstall Abbey, still beautiful and beguiling, despite one king's best efforts several centuries ago. Catherine, you're curator of archaeology.
That's right.
Here's your chance to impress us with some facts and figures about this abbey, Kirkstall Abbey.
Well, monks arrived here from Fountains Abbey originally in 1152, and within the first 30 years here, they'd completed all the main buildings of the abbey you see in front of you now. The monks were Cistercian monks, which meant they were incredibly strict and followed the rules of St Benedict. And in order to fulfil their daily duties to God, they had to live in an incredibly isolated environment. Now, if you look around you, you can see that we're actually in Leeds at the moment, but at the time when they arrived here, there was nothing here. There was a quiet valley with woodland and the river flowing past, and it was an incredibly good location for the monks to be.
So that's the River Aire. That must have been very important for the monks.
It was. Actually, the monks were way ahead of their time in terms of water management. They used it to clear away waste systems. They had toilets, flushing toilets, that you'd never think would have been around in medieval times. They used the water, obviously, for drinking and cooking. They used it for transport and to power their corn mills and also in the iron forge industries.
One can't help but notice that there's quite a lot of the abbey missing. When did the majority of this damage take place?
Well, the abbey was dissolved in 1539 by Henry VIII, and the monks left the abbey. After that time, a lot of the abbey fell into disrepair. Obviously, nobody was taking care of it. And a lot of the stone you see was taken to make the structures in Leeds. Actually, Leeds Bridge, the steps leading up to Leeds Bridge, are constructed out of Kirkstall Abbey stone, and it was just used as a quarry for local people.
So local people would just come along and take bits of stone?
Absolutely. It was there. It was a free-for-all.
What area is this, then?
This is the cloister of Kirkstall Abbey, and this was the open space that connects all the really important buildings of the abbey. Behind me is the church, and then you can see as well the chapter house, which were the most sort of religious buildings of the abbey. Now, this would have been a space of contemplation and reflection for the monks. It would have been a silent area, but a place where perhaps they could copy out manuscripts or read their sort of holy books.
And there's a good example of the new mixing with the old up there as well.
Absolutely. We decided to place a modern roof on both the aisles of the church to give an impression of the roof, what the roof would have looked like. And as you can see underneath, people are often surprised at how bright the stone is that we've placed there, but this actually reflects the colour of the stone when it was initially built. All the blackened stone you see around you is from the Industrial Revolution. We have Leeds nearby, all the smoke coming out, all the pollution, and it's really blackened the stone.
And is it local stone?
Yes, it was actually quarried at Bramley Fall, which is a local quarry.
And how would they get it here?
They used the River Aire. They transported the stone down the river. It was a perfect location.
Is there anybody that we have to thank for making sure that this didn't fall into ruins?
Well, actually, the abbey came up for auction in the 19th century because the families who owned it were, you know, in a lot of debt. And Colonel North, who was a local Leeds man and had made a lot of money, bought the abbey for £10,000 and donated it to the City of Leeds, which is now why it's in the hands of Leeds City Council.
Aren't we lucky?
We are. If he hadn't made that generous offer, it would have fallen into disrepair and been, you know, made into flats by now or something.
How bad did it get?
Well, at one point, the abbey had vegetation growing out of it. You know, it really did look a mess. It was in a terrible state, but it did capture the imagination of artists and poets of the Romantic movement who came here. Turner, Rhodes, all these famous artists came and painted the abbey. So it actually made it quite famous and saved it, I think.
So would it be fair to say that without the River Aire, none of this would have happened?
Absolutely. They would never have built an abbey in this location if it wasn't for the River Aire. The Cistercians needed a natural source of water in order to survive.
It's very important stuff, water, isn't it?
It is.
Kathleen, thanks very much for all the information.
No problem.
Now, I have to say, this next location that we're heading off to is something really special to me because I'm actually going home. You see, I was born in Guiseley in Yorkshire quite a few years ago now, but despite the fact that I went all over the country with my work and despite the fact that I now live in the northwest, I still like to get back to Yorkshire as often as possible. And today, the Leeds-Liverpool Canal has certainly helped to carry me back in time. Fish and chips. Now, these taste very good, but when I was a child, they tasted even better because I used to get fish and chips free of charge. You see, this guy here, the world-famous Harry Ramsden, was my great Uncle Harry. Hence, I got free fish and chips. And what's more, my parents actually met in this very restaurant, so I've got quite a lot to be grateful for. He was quite a character, and I remember him very well looking exactly like that, wing collar and all. Memories, memories. Great Uncle Harry used to live in that house. This is Great Uncle Harry's original hut, where he served fish and chips. He opened this in 1928. Here he is now. He used to pick me up when I was little, so I can pick him up now. After 3 years of serving fish and chips in this little hut, it was so successful that he could afford to build the big restaurant. 21 years later, in 1952, he celebrated it by having a penny halfpenny day where all the fish and chips were sold at the original price that they had been in 1928. And guess who got to play the piano to celebrate that day? My dad, Harry Corbett. Way to Saltaire, but I've heard that there's a particularly difficult swing bridge that we're approaching, so I reckon I'd better lend a hand. I've got the trusty windlass. Here we go. So, Darren, I gather that this is a difficult bridge. Is that the right word to describe it?
It can be. It can be described as many things. It's a very annoying bridge for boaters.
Is it? Why is that? Hated.
It's just confusing to do, and there's no other bridge like it on the system.
Where do we start?
Well, we'll start by lowering the barriers with the BWB key, which is the only barriers that you have to lower on the bridge on the canal system.
Right.
And then what happens is you have to use your windlass, which you use obviously on the locks.
Got it.
You have to retract the wedges by turning anti-clockwise 18 turns. You do that and then obviously you bring the bridge back with the windlass
yeah.
and then insert the wedges, which is 36 turns.
I'm glad you're here. 30, 40, 50. 16, 17, 18 turns. And it stopped. Do I leave it on there?
No, you need to take your windlass off and now put it onto this one.
It won't spring back.
It won't, no.
Okay. Oh dear, I'm so glad you're here.
We'll get there in the end.
Yes, we will. We're cooking on gas. It's better than going to the gym, this. This is actually why you see a lot of ladies on canals doing winding the locks up because they say it's better than going to the gymnasium. That's certainly the case. With me and my wife. Well, that's my excuse for staying doing the steering. Right, we're in position. Gonna call our boat through now. So, same in reverse?
It is indeed, yes.
Okay, well, here we go. And how old is this bridge, you reckon?
I think it's about 25 years old.
And you maintain this?
Yeah, we maintain it, keep an eye on it, to oil it, fill all levels up.
And do you consider it's like
your baby. Is this your bridge?
Well, everything's my baby on the canal. I think everyone gets a passion for the work that they do on the canal. So you nurture everything, really. Every lock, every bridge, every gate.
How are we doing? Are we nearly there?
We're nearly there. Lovely. Okay. And now you're 36 turns. This is the best part.
36? I'm winding this up. You're winding me up. I'm sure you are, isn't it? One, two. Darren, feel how stiff this is. Just feel this. Feel that. I'm sure there's something wrong. See you later.
We'll continue along the Leeds-Liverpool Canal, but not for long, as we're soon surrounded by a very different, but equally as distinctive structure, Salt's Mill. The fascinating story of Saltaire was hatched by the revolutionary mind of industrialist Sir Titus Salt, who supplied the thousands of mill workers who earned him his wealth with a hospital, a school, and this, their very own village, standing next to the canal that carried their work from coast to coast.
So where did he get the idea from to build this huge mill and an entire community?
There were lots and lots of examples for him to follow around. He knew about New Lanark in Scotland, for example, with Robert Owen and his model village there. There are model villages in Halifax that he knew about that predate Saltaire. So the idea of having a model utopian village was not an unusual one to him. But also he wanted to escape the cholera in Bradford, he wanted to escape from the high rates in Bradford that were just being imposed. There were lots and lots of reasons why he decided on this.
And so you mentioned dates. I mean, what is the date of this whole?
The mill was opened in 1853, just 2 years after Titus Salt commissioned his architect to provide the initial plans for him.
We're standing on the bank of the Leeds-Liverpool Canal, so chicken and egg situation. Was it the canal first or the mill first?
Absolutely, the canal was here first. In 1777, this canal was already built. Titus didn't have to provide any of the infrastructure here. We've got a canal here. Next to it, we've got the River Aire, which provided water for his boilers and for washing his raw materials. And then further up the road, up Victoria Road, we've got a railway. And the railway was built by 1848. It was already in place. He didn't have any of the infrastructure to pay for. He just got on with building his mill.
And what did he manufacture?
He manufactured alpaca worsted. Now, in Lancashire, it's cotton they produce. In the rest of Yorkshire, it's wool. Here, it's a mixture. It's a mixed cloth. The alpaca and the coal were all offloaded from the canal into this building here. All the processes of production were all under one roof, very much different to what it was in Bradford, where there were mills for spinning, mills for weaving, and they had to transport the material between the mills each time. Here, everything's under one roof.
And so it was a commercial success, I presume?
Absolutely. 18 miles of cloth every single day were produced in this mill, making Titus Salt huge amounts of profit.
And he was a very shrewd cookie because he made this community for everybody, didn't he? A village.
He did. It was very shrewd because it makes a lot of economic sense. When you think about it, not only to have an integrated mill, but to have a workforce that you can absolutely rely on. They're healthy, they're well-fed, and they're available on-site. They're committed to your enterprise. They're a compliant workforce, just what you want.
What were the halcyon days? How long was it successful for before it fell into decline?
Well, the decline came in about 1987. Illingworth Morris had taken over from a number of consortia that had run the mill until then. And Illingworth Morris hived off part of the production to their subsidiaries. So it began to go downhill, and gradually it wound down until there was no production at all here.
But this is a new era. The place is reborn, is that not correct?
That's absolutely true, yes. It's wonderful to be in Saltaire.
And how did that come about?
There are two main reasons. One of them was that the railway was reopened. It was closed in the beaching era in the 60s. And then it was reopened again in the 80s. That was a wonderful thing for the village. It brought people back in here. And the second factor was Jonathan Silver. Jonathan and Maggie Silver took over this mill, bought it in 1987. And within months, Jonathan's creativity and his energy had opened up the 1853 gallery and opened up a restaurant here. He was a real workaholic, just like Titus Salt, the two personalities, as charismatic as one another, both with that same sort of energy and vision for the future. Unfortunately, Jonathan has died too early in his 40s, but his wife Maggie and his brother Robin continue to run the mill behind us.
So to sum up, Roger, what is the legacy that Sir Titus Salt has left behind?
He's left us this wonderful village that is more or less exactly as it was when he died. It's been changed very, very little. But he's also left us a legacy of being concerned about environment and being concerned for each other as well. Be concerned about environment and you get healthier workers. You also get workers who look after each other just as he looked after them, they cared for each other too.
Fantastic. You looked after me. Thank you very much indeed.
All right.
Famous 3 and 5 rise staircase locks, we climb higher still through Kildwick and onto the southern tip of one of our most treasured national parks. Today's going to bring back lots of memories for me because this is my old stomping ground. We're actually at the Bingley 3 Rise Locks, and we're going to make our way to the very famous Bingley 5 Rise Locks en route to the edge of the Yorkshire Dales. The north of England must feel very privileged as it plays host to the vast majority of the legendary 7 wonders of the waterways. And one man who knows every nook and cranny of each of them is historian and author Mike Clark. So Mike, these 7 wonders of the waterways, who compiled the list?
Well, it's done by Robert Aikman just after the war. And he was quite a sort of iconic person in his own right. He set up was one of the people who set up the Inland Waterways Association. And he wrote a book about waterways in the 1950s. And it included a chapter all about the 7 wonders of the waterways. Part of the promotion for them, I think, was to develop this idea of iconic structures that had really captured the imagination 200 years ago and can still capture the imagination today.
Of course, one of those iconic structures we're standing on it now, being
well, it
5
is.
Rise.
It's fantastic, isn't it? I
mean, how does it rate in terms of the 7 wonders?
I think it's a really interesting structure. It has its sort of drawbacks that the technology it uses, where you have locks coupled up together, only lasted until really just after this was opened in 1773. From the 1780s, people went to single locks because this type of system uses too much water. It's fine in the early days when there wasn't a lot of goods being moved about, but by the time we get into the Industrial Revolution in 1790, its days have gone.
Who was responsible for the design and the engineering?
The engineer for this, the canal was a chap called Longbottom, who came from Halifax.
It's a fine old north of England name, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Longbottom.
He'd worked with Brindley, and Brindley was also used this sort of technology, the riser locks, where the top gate of one lock becomes the bottom gate of the next lock. So all the chambers are coupled up together. So we've got five locks here, one after the other, without a gap in between. They have to have them here because the canal, these early canals, this is opened in 1773, were very much contour canals. And so coming up here, we're following the edge of the Aire Valley, and we've just got to this sort of slightly steeper bit, and so they need to get up, it's 60 feet here, another 30-odd feet at the three rise below. So the canal needs to get up 100 feet in quite a short space of time or length, and so that's why they went for these locks built together. You can put the rise very close in a very short space of time.
So what about the legacy that Robert Aikman left behind? Can you sum that up?
One way that Robert Aikman actually made people more aware of canals was by publicising these iconic structures. And that's one of the things that went to saving them in the 50s and 60s, when they were very close to being closed. But in some ways, you needed people like that at the time, who actually pushed forward the idea of preserving the canals. If it hadn't been for this small group of people in the late 1940s and early 50s, in particular setting up the Inland Waterways Association as a sort of a body to fight for the waterways, and they needed to fight for them at that time, we wouldn't have all this wonderful environment left for us today.
I have to agree, nothing quite beats a day on the water, and certainly when you feel like you're back where you belong. It's just a feeling I've got, but somehow I feel that this is Yorkshire. It's different to other waterways. I'm not very used to the Leeds Liverpool Canal, but this is definitely a Yorkshire feel. Dry stone walling and the size of the fields, and then those dramatic hills over there. We're definitely in Yorkshire. When I was a little boy, my auntie used to live by the side of the canal, and I remember my mum wasn't very keen to go to my auntie's house because she said it's not a very nice place to live. There's all those dirty boats in that dirty canal and those people on the boats, and it really was not a good place to live. My goodness me, look at this now, look how things have changed. These are des reses, and you can understand why, because outside of your front room window, look at the views, look at all that. Where have you come from?
Skipton.
Skipton, we're just going there. Here's a sight you don't very often see. Pirates on the canal. You think I'm joking? Have a look over there. Ahoy there, mates! What are you doing? What? What are you doing? And more pirates! Ahoy there! You having a good day? Well, yo ho ho, Andy! Goodbye!
We're sorted!
First time I've heard that today. You won't believe this. About 4 minutes ago, it was bright sunshine. Now look at it. Looks like something out of Omen 3, doesn't it? Never mind, it's only about 4 miles to Skipton. That's if we don't drown in the meantime.
Boatmen and women love nothing better than a good gossip, and they have done for decades. Take Kildwick, for example, where the bridge ahead of me can tell a story that even now may or may not be true. As you'll see, St Andrew's Church and the majority of its graves are separated by the canal, and local folklore suggests that before this bridge was built, parishioners relied on boats to transfer coffins from one side to the other. And that's no job for anyone, no matter what the weather.
We're about 3 miles short of Skipton, but before we moor up for the night, there's a couple of guys I especially want to meet up here by Hamblethorpe Swing Bridge. And these guys are responsible for a very special canalside monument. It says on the memorial, lest we forget, so obviously it's some sort of war memorial. Peter, can you explain more?
1943, September, only about 100 yards from where we stood, a Wellington from Silloth in Cumbria on a training flight, crashed with a crew of seven Poles on board. Sadly, they all lost their lives. Two of them had done combat operations with the Royal Air Force. One, in fact, the navigator had flown 46 operations. And it was sad, really, that they had to lose their life in what was an accident. They were flying down the valley, low altitude, 1,500 feet, and a wing broke off just up the valley from where we stood. And the aircraft, as I said, crashed about 100 yards away.
Who had the idea to put a memorial up?
Well, I walk my little West Island White Terrier along the canal bank, and every time I walk past where they had a plane crash, I think to myself, seven men killed here, and nobody has ever done a thing about it. And it wasn't until I visited my local barber, who was cutting away at the little bit of hair I have left, and I just happened to mention it to Jeff. And he said, do you think something should be done about it, Jim? I said, well, honestly, I said, seven men and nothing's there to tell anybody what happened. And so Jeff got in touch with my friend here, Peter, and from that day on, it just snowballed.
Jim and Peter's fundraising efforts enabled the memorial to be unveiled in 2007, when in the presence of the airman's family, a military flypast poignantly reminded everyone of those that were lost and that now are rightly and respectfully remembered. There's a right rural feel to today's journey, with the route from Skipton to East Martin lined with stunning, serene canal scenery as we prepare to bid ta-ta to Yorkshire. I'm ready to jump off the Ward Aldham to explore Skipton and the spring branch of the canal that leads up to its castle. As boaters enter the town, they can turn right to continue along the Leeds-Liverpool Canal or moor up and leisurely walk along the pathway to the left.
This is a spring branch arm just off Skipton Marina. We're only a few minutes from the town here. Now, I know it looks a little bit overgrown and possibly a little bit unloved, but it's still fully navigable. And up there, wow, look at that. That is Skipton Castle, and I'm hoping to be up there very soon. Sebastian, Skipton Castle, it really is fantastic, breathtaking. The word Skipton, where does that come from?
The word Skipton comes from the Saxon word skeep.
Skeep, and what's that?
A skeep is actually a sheep. So this is sheep town.
Okay, so was there like a marketplace before the castle, or did the castle come before the market?
Well, I'm not absolutely sure, but it probably wasn't a marketplace, but there would be a little Saxon settlement on this hill.
Has it seen action?
Oh, yes. It's been in three civil wars. Pilgrim of Grace, which was in 1530, and then we had the War of the Roses, where this was actually a Lancastrian castle, fighting for the Henry V. And then the last major battle was the English Civil War, when this was the last royalist outpost in the north of England. And we surrendered on favourable terms, and all the soldiers were allowed to march out with their colours flying and bullets in their mouths. So we're very proud of that.
And that was the last action that it saw, was it?
Last major bit of action. There would have been the odd scuffles after that.
Yes, and now the scuffles are with the tourists, is that right? It's just a tourist event.
No, we love those scuffles. They're good scuffles to have, so.
These are just incredible, incredible views. It's so stunningly beautiful, but at the same time, it's a bit scary, isn't it? How high are we here?
I think we're about over 100 metres. It's a good position for a castle because it's a very defensive thing to have, this height difference. And we're facing north, so it would have kept all the Scots out, which was the main aim.
I bet it would. I can see three distinct pieces of water here. One's the canal, isn't it, that one there?
Yeah, the first one's the spring branch of the canal. But originally, it was for one of the Earls of Thanet had a quarry up the hill, and to get the stone from the quarry, he basically transported it to the end of the castle, chucked it off the bank into the canal, and some of the boats used to sink when the stone used to go straight through the bottom of the boats.
And so what we're seeing here is an arm, but it ends just there, doesn't it?
Yeah, it was built just to transport limestone from one of the quarries up the hill here. So, I mean, it didn't need to go any further. So you see further down there, there's a turning point for the horses. So they used to take the boats, apparently, 2 weeks to get from Skipton up to this point, the end of the canal, Spring Branch, get filled up with stone, and then go back towards the Leeds Liverpool Canal.
I'm sort of recognising it now because we've walked along there, but it looks so totally different from up here. Oh, wow. More fantastic views. Wow. We see right over Skipton, can't we?
You can. In the distance over there, you can see Pendle Hill.
Yeah.
Which is in Lancashire, you know, the Witches of Pendle.
Yes. Over here, there's a motto carved in stone. What does that mean? What does it say?
It says Désormais, and that's a Clifford motto, meaning henceforth. And the Clifford Lords owned Skipton Castle from 1310 until, basically, until 1956.
You can read that both ways, coming in the castle?
You can, yes. It's on the front as you come in, meaning, you know, from now on, here we go. And when you leave, you know, that same thought travels with you.
Well, I've lived in Yorkshire all my life. I've never been to Skipton Castle before, but I have to say, I'm going to come back again one day. It's beautiful. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
I've got a boat to catch. Thank you.
I'm terribly sorry for holding you up. I'm very sorry. You've got a load of shopping as well. I'm sorry I can't help you by carrying it. Sorry about that. I must say that's quite unusual. Never seen that before. So many swans in one place. Be somebody with a very large loaf of bread somewhere. Narrowboats are as varied as, say, cars are. There's different sorts, different qualities, in fact. There are standard narrowboats and there are tug narrowboats. This is a standard one, standard lines. You see it's quite high out of the water, the gunwale, that's the bit that you walk along the side. And it has ordinary windows. Square windows like a house would have. This is the same, this has got square windows. So that's an ordinary narrowboat. That's got a cruise astern, means there's room for social activities. This, on the other hand, is a tug. It's lower in the water and it doesn't have square windows, it's got portholes. So it's goodbye to glorious Skipton as we make our way to Liverpool, which is 98 and a quarter miles. Britain's waterways are used for all manner of pursuits and causes. And with my trusty travel guitar to keep me company, you could say that I'm happy with life today. But trust me, I've been boating for long enough to know that there may be more than one storm cloud on the horizon.
When a roller got worn or damaged, it fell out for a period of time, possibly with no roller, and them groove marks was a result of it. Most of the waterways, and I think it's one on its own. Not sailed the Leeds and Liverpool, we'll recognise it from photographs. Everybody talks about it when I come across and get chatted to people.
And I happen to know that you have a little evil streak that says that one night after you've had a few pints, what is it you'd like to do?
Well, it'd be something, dress it up in old clothes and put it in the top arch, you know. Waving to boats going through, you know.
So, Alan, Hull is back that away.
Yep.
Liverpool's that away.
Liverpool's that way.
And East Martin is, in fact, it's like a milestone, isn't it? Because it marks the highest point.
Well, the highest point between watersheds. You've got a little bit further along here, a few miles. You've got the watershed where the rain falling. One side of the canal, it runs into the River Erne and the North Sea. The other side, into the River Ribble and the Irish Sea.
And now we're changing counties.
And then you change, and the same, particularly the same area, you're changing the counties.
Within a mile or so, I'll arrive at Greenbuffield Locks near Barn Oldswick. This is such a splendid scene that the locals often have to share the canal with more than anglers or boaters. But these Lancastrians are, it is said, still a little confused about where to pin their colours, as their homes were actually a part of Yorkshire until the county board was moved in 1974. But one thing which is not in dispute is the fact that they are living in the highest town along the entire Leeds-Liverpool Canal. And after all,
We're all northern, and rightfully proud of it too. So I can't say I blame either county for wanting to claim this beautiful area as their own.
We're saying farewell to my home county, but we haven't quite finished with the White Rose just yet. Meanwhile, over in Red Rose County, I promise you the water is just as nice.